Good morning and welcome to Community Church. If you'd stand with us, we're going to begin in a time of worship.
Morning, everybody. I'm all the way over here. Sorry about that. Changing sides. Going to just see if you're awake. Everybody looks beautiful in their masks. We have some very decorative masks. I'm very excited for you. If you're joining us online, hey, just put your mask on at home, just because. Then you'll kind of fit in with the rest of us here. Welcome to Community Church. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors on staff here, and we are so excited to have you here today. And thank you for coming. Thank you for respecting our requests for masks inside this morning. We can still worship loudly even with those things on, right? That just means, wow, that was actually kind of lame. We can still worship loudly, correct? Amen. There we go. Hey, I'm going to have to do that more often. Hey, if it is your first time here, we are so excited for you to be with us. If you're watching online for the very first time, thank you for joining us online as well. And hey, since we don't hand out bulletins and we can't have little tear-off cards or things you fill out, If you are new here, we would still like to connect and have a way to say hi, introduce ourselves, learn your name, and all you need to do is text the word connect, text it to 812-575-4229. That's 812-575-4229. And one of the reasons I'm way over here, and one of the reasons we have a new face way over here, is my next thing, so I'm going to scoot over. So I am so excited to introduce this guy right here. This is Caleb Hunter. Everybody say, hey, Caleb.
Hey.
And I'd like to bring up Caleb's family, his beautiful wife, Megan, and Nora. Nora's how old?
Two.
Nora's two, and Briley is?
He'll be a year and 2 weeks.
Okay, Briley's almost here. Come on up. We'll make room for you guys up here. So as you know, we have been searching for a worship director for quite a while now. And we've been very fortunate to have volunteers filling gaps, to have Josh help us out. And we are so excited to have Caleb join us on staff. He joined us just a couple weeks ago. The reason you might not have seen him till now is because once you get up here, it's hard to get off. So we've had him backstage and learning how things work backstage first. But he's been on board with us a couple weeks, and we are so glad to have him. It's kind of a God thing, the way it's ended up him being with us. But I'm going to let Caleb introduce his family a little bit more and tell you about themselves.
So this is my wife, Megan, and my daughter, Nora, and my son, Briley. If it were up to Nora, she already told me that she wants to play piano and sing for us. Can you say hello?
Hello.
We're really excited to be here and just this opportunity to serve and share our passion with you, and just excited for this next season of life for us as being a part of Community Church. And I thank you for welcoming us into your family.
They are a wonderful family, and I hope you take some time to say hi. I know we can't hug and handshake like we normally do, but please make them feel welcome. We're so glad to have them as part of our family. Now, a couple things. One, when I see a two-year-old grab the mic like that, I think future singer for the praise team automatically. So we're going to audition her next week. Second, I'm a little disappointed because we hired another guy with a full head of hair. And just once again, feel discriminated against. But anyways, we would love the chance to be able to pray for you guys. I would appreciate if after the service you guys would seek them out and make them feel welcome. They will be moving to our Greensburg community here shortly. Caleb's office will be there, but you will see him a ton. So we are so glad to have him here. Let me pray to open our service and to welcome you guys as well. Dear Lord, we come to you this morning and we're thankful for the opportunity to gather together. Doesn't matter what we're asked to put on and the laws on face masks and touching and whatever else, we will still glorify and worship you while we do all that. We are so thankful that you are a God that continues to work, even through this pandemic and unrest in our country. And we're so glad for Caleb and for Megan and for their two kids joining our family, joining our team here. We look forward to what you have in store through them here at the church, but what you have in store in them as a result of them joining our family. I ask that you be with our time together this morning, whether we're at home watching in our living room or whether we're here with face masks on. May we sing at the top of our lungs as we sing praise to you. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
You guys go ahead and stand with us. Sing, I need you.
I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. Thank you. Holy, overwhelming.
One, two.
This is a new song this morning. It's called Joy. I think it's appropriate when we're facing times like this pandemic to remember that our joy comes from God and not our situations or our circumstances.
Trust in you, Jesus, you're all, you're all, you're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting in you. You give us hope and life that's forever. You make us bold and we stand together. This journey, there's no looking back. With Jesus to lead us, we're on the right track. Oh, oh, oh.
spaces for wide open eyes. We're looking ahead for the next big surprise. Oh, 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 oh.
Well, if you couldn't tell, we had an awesome, awesome time this week at our Vacation Bible School. Just for fun, how many people in here in one way or another helped with Vacation Bible School this week? Could we give them a hand, please? It's true that it takes a village, and this week it took a village. Last week with the mask mandate, we were thrown a new curve, and we took that on, and we had an incredible time with the kids here. Things were a little bit different, and we had a different process, different pickup and drop off. But what didn't change were kids came excited to be here, excited to spend time with us, and for us to be able to share and show them the love of Jesus through last week. So if you didn't notice, we had a train theme. We had Carrie Bartell and John Bosler. You might not have noticed him in his engineer costume there up front leading the kids every evening. And it was just a tremendous time of spending time with them, having fun, but then still instilling into them the good news of Jesus and how he cares for them. Now, I know if you've been here for any length of time, or even if you're new watching, you may have heard us say it before, but our vision here at Community Church is to be creating a community where all people can connect to God's story. And when we say that, we don't just mean all us big people up here in this room each Sunday. We mean the kiddos downstairs that every week parents and families entrust into us, not just so that we can teach them about Jesus, but so that we can show them, so that we can love on them and invest on them. And so I am so thankful for everybody that showed up this week after week. And let me tell you how you can tell if they served at Vacation Bible School. If you ask them how they're doing and they look a little tired, they were here. It was a long week, but it was a great week. We have so much to be thankful for. As I told you the last couple weeks, we had almost as many kids here this week as kids that attend our as many kids here this week that were visitors. Folks that didn't go to our church, as were kids that came here week after week. And it was such a great opportunity to be able to love on them and get to know them a little better. We're so hopeful that some of them will continue things they've learned here. I know we had one little girl pray to accept Jesus as her Savior for the first time. And it was just a fantastic week. And we couldn't do it without you, our church. Because whether or not you helped this week, what you guys do here serving, what you do giving financially makes that possible. We were the only church that I'm aware of in our community that did Vacation Bible School this year, and it was such a blessing to be able to do that. So thank you so much for your continuing partnership. If you have not partnered with us before with giving, there's a couple ways you can give. We don't pass plates on Sundays, but we have a couple offering boxes as you walk out and in the back. And, of course, you can go online. If you're watching online, go to give.icommunitychurch.com. But would you join me as I pray to thank God for what a tremendous week we had with the kids and that he would continue to work in their hearts. Would you pray with me? Dear Lord, I look back at this week and I'm so thankful for the opportunity we had as a church, the opportunity we had as your hands and feet to be able to love on kids that came in this week. They were so excited to be here without much else going on this summer. They were so excited to be with their friends and to have an activity like Vacation Bible School, but you had more in store for them than that. And we know that you taught them some powerful lessons. We got feedback from their families that there were some kids that are going through some tough times that needed to hear what you had to say to them this week. So I just pray, and not just a word of thanks for this week, but I pray that you will continue working in those kids' hearts, because those kids are your future church, your future kingdom. And so I ask that as a church, as a community, that we will come alongside those families. And I just ask that you continue to use Community Church in Batesville and in Greensburg to further your kingdom. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
To meet, and I hope once you know you're comfortable joining us in person, we would love to have you back, especially if you live here in Indiana. If you don't live here in Indiana, I hope you'll visit sometime when you're in the state, but we'd love to have you here. So those of you who are school age, how many of you are ready to go back to school this week? How many of you parents are ready to send your kids back to school after this extended? Yeah, all right. We can relate, right? Awesome. Well, hey, we're in this series called When Life Gives You Lemons, and today we're actually bringing this whole series to a close, which means that if you're here for the first time, or you haven't been with us, or you haven't been keeping up with us over the last several weeks, you're kind of getting in at the end of the story, right? It's like reading the last chapter of a book or sitting in the last 30 minutes of a movie. And so some of this may not make sense, but I want to invite you, go to our website, icommunitychurch.com, and you can check that out, and you can catch up on everything that we've been talking about as we've been examining the life of a person from the Old Testament. His name is Joseph, and we've been learning some lessons from his life, and we'll get to all that here in just a minute. But before we do, I want to test you. I want to see how much you've been paying attention. Those of you who are watching online, you can type your answer into the chat bar or into the chat box there. But we've been saying something over and over throughout this series, that when life gives you lemons, you can trust that God is, anybody know? Oh my gosh, the energy is lacking. Let's hear it real loud. Go ahead, put it on there. Let's all just say the sentence together. Ready? When life gives you lemons, you can trust God is making lemonade. Yes, good. I'm glad three of you were paying attention for the last 4 weeks. I'm doing a great job as a teacher. Okay, anyway, so the thing that we've been talking about, the thing that you know, is that regardless of your background, regardless of your socioeconomic status, your gender, you know, your educational background, regardless of all of those things, life gives everyone lemons. Life gives everyone lemons. We all get them. And it feels like in 2020, we've all been run over by the lemon truck. It just feels like we've had so many lemons here this year. But the truth is, and you know this, you've had lemons before 2020, right? I mean, lemons weren't invented in 2020. You had them in years past, and I could probably ask you to recount some lemons that you had in your history. And we all know that life kind of gives us lemons. But what we've been talking about is, how do we deal with the lemons that life gives us? And so in order to do that, we've been looking at the life of a person named Joseph, as I said, from the Old Testament. There are two Josephs in the Bible, Joseph and Mary, Jesus' earthly parents. And then there's this Joseph from the book of Genesis. And it would be so hard to recount all that we've talked about in this. As I said, go back and catch up if you missed any of these. But we've been learning some lessons from the lemons that he dealt with in life. And he had a boatload of lemons. And so what do we do with the lemons that we have? Now, here's the thing that's interesting, because when I think about Joseph's life, when I think about all that he went through, all that he accomplished, the things that we remember about his life, it's not the high points and it's not the low points. It's not the points when he had lemons or when things weren't very lemony. It's how he responded. It's what he did with the lemons. In fact, we could say this: the thing that defined Joseph's life, it wasn't the presence or the absence of lemons. It wasn't the highs and lows, of which he had numerous. It wasn't his riches to rags to riches to rags to riches story that so many of us, we grew up hearing, or you may be familiar with if you watched Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat. I mean, it's not that. It's what he did in response to the lemons that was the defining piece of his life. Because here's the thing, and you know that. You know that we all deal with lemons. In fact, it's possible you know somebody who's had a lot of lemons in life, and sometimes people are defined by their lemons. You know what I'm talking about? Maybe you know somebody like that who every time you talk to them, they talk about the negative experiences they had and how bad and how sour their life is. It's like they've been sucking on lemons. I only suck on lemons when I go to restaurants, but if you ever suck on them, you know what happens to your face, right? It's like, you know, it kind of makes this contorted little look, and that's what happens when we suck on those lemons in life. And sometimes there are people who are, we call them Debbie Downers, who, you know, think that everything bad happens to them and it happens to no one else. But if you and I were to sit down, and if I were to listen to your life story, my guess is you could recount all kinds of lemons. And if I were then to, you know, share my life story, I could share all kinds of lemons as well. And maybe we'd compare and decide who had more or who had fewer. Some people do get more than others. But here's the thing that I know. That at funerals, nobody talks about how sour a person's life was. Right? I mean, there's no laundry list of how many lemons they dealt with and all the stuff that they went through in life. The thing at funerals that comes up is how somebody handled the lemons they were given in life. You could say this, what defines your life isn't your lemons, but your attitude in response to them. And if you have to, you know, leave early, if your internet cuts out, for those of you who are watching online, if you just want to know the bottom line of everything we're going to talk about today as we sum up Joseph's life and we kind of look at the end of the story, it all rests in this. What defines your life isn't your lemons, but your attitude. Your attitude in response to the lemons that you receive in life. Now, you may think that's kind of a big statement to make, Seth. You know, how could you make such a big statement? And I get why you might ask that. But here's the thing that you and I both know. Most of life is not super fantastic, wonderful living the dream, right? I mean, much of life, it's not super fantastic, wonderful living the dream. Nobody lives that way. Nobody gets to live at Disney World all day long. And even if you did, you'd probably get tired of it. Nobody, you know, gets to eat cake all day and never gain weight. Nobody's relationships are perfect 100%. Nobody's relationships are perfect 100% of the time. In fact, most of life is mundane, something happy, mundane. I mean, isn't that the truth? I mean, when you think about, you know, living the dream, changing diapers, you know, living the dream, you know, going through conflict at work, living the dream, mowing the lawn, which is some of your living the dream that I don't get, but, you know, living the dream, doing whatever it is that, you know, that's just not how life works. Now, the problem is we look on social media, where it's 24/7 excitement 100% of the time, and we get this illusion that everything's going great, but I'm gonna let you in on a little secret. The average person in 2019 who uses social media spent 2 hours and 22 minutes a day on social media. And I'm just telling you, if they have that kind of time in their life to spend posting pictures and looking what everybody else is doing, they're not living the dream. Okay, so the pictures that they post, it's not living the dream anyway. So that's just life. I mean, life is difficult. Life is challenging. In fact, let me ask you this question, and those of you watching online, I mean, you can post in the chat box or whatever, and don't answer this question before I get through all of it, okay? So I know you're going to be tempted to raise your hand early, but don't raise your hand. How many of you live the dream every waking moment of every day with no financial problems, no relational problems, no work problems, no health problems, and no bowel problems? Yeah, look around. Nobody's raising their hands. I mean, that's just life. I mean, that's just what life is. And so we have to decide how we're going to respond to the lemons that we are given. Now, here's the thing, because if you came here today and you're not a church person really, or, you know, you have questions about who God is and you're not sure you believe in Jesus, I get there's probably a question looming behind the scenes, and you may be thinking this, and if you are, then I guess I predicted what you were going to ask, but I'm going to just take a second to address this, because I think it really is a question that's begged through this, and that is, why do people have to have lemons? Right? I mean, why do we have to have lemons in the first place? Why didn't God just, you know, dump gallons of Chick-fil-A lemonade on us? Because that's good lemonade. I mean, why didn't he just give that to us? Why does there have to be difficulty and strife in life? And I don't know a whole lot, but here's one thing I know, that the book of Genesis in the beginning, as we kind of recount the history of Christianity and Judaism and God, I mean, the thing that we discover is that Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, they made a decision not to obey God. And as a result, there was difficulty and there was strife and there were lemons. God even said, it is going to be hard for you now. It is going to be hard for you. I don't know why, but I know that that's true. And I know that I've experienced that in my own life, and you have too, because life is hard. 2020 has been a hard year. The pandemic has been hard. And even somebody who pretends like everything is going perfect, I just trust me in this, it's not. It's not. Life is challenging. And so it's not whether or not life is challenging, because remember, the series is called When Life Gives You Lemons, not If Life Gives You Lemons, When Life Gives You Lemons, how will you respond and what will your character be? What will your attitude be in the midst of those? And that's where we connect back to Joseph's life, because in spite of everything that he experienced, from the highest of highs to the lowest of lows, from a hopeful future with dreams of prosperity to an auction block and a prison cell, Joseph experienced so much, and the thing is, he persevered through all of it, and his character of all things remained intact in spite of it. So today we're going to close out his story. I'm going to do my best to do just a really quick overview of this, and I want to give you a heads up. We're going to cover a whole bunch of ground in Scripture, and we're going to read a whole bunch. I'm going to skip over actually more than I read, so that'll tell you how much we're going through. And if you have time this afternoon or later this week, I would just encourage you. This is the longest narrative portion in the book of Genesis, Joseph's life. We know more about Joseph's life than even Abraham, Father Abraham. So remarkable account, and I'm going to do my best to kind of move through it quickly and give us the highlights. But to catch you up of where we have been, Joseph was the son of a man named Jacob. Jacob was Father Abraham's grandson. Abraham had a son named Isaac. Isaac had two sons, Jacob, Esau, and then Jacob had 12 sons. Joseph was the favorite of the 12. And because of that, his brothers hated him. They sold him into slavery. He was sold into slavery to Egypt, where he lived inside a man named Potiphar's house, and Potiphar's wife falsely accused him of sexual assault. As a result, Joseph was thrown in prison. He was there for a number of years until finally Pharaoh had dreams, and through a random set of circumstances, they came to Joseph, seeing if he could interpret Pharaoh's dreams. And so Joseph was brought out. He interpreted Pharaoh's dreams that there'd be 7 years of plenty in the land of Egypt, and then there would be 7 years of extreme famine. And so last week, where we picked up the story, Joseph was overseeing the distribution of grain because there were these 7 years of plenty. There was so much grain, they couldn't even keep up with it all. And lo and behold, his brothers came to Egypt looking for grain. They came there. They didn't know they were talking to Joseph. He accused them of being spies. And so Joseph kept one of the brothers and said, I want to know about my youngest brother, Benjamin, and I want him to come back, although he didn't say it was his brother. But he said, you know, bring Benjamin back, and then I will set Simeon free. Simeon was the one who got kept as collateral damage. And so the brothers, they returned home. They told their father about their experience. And that's where we pick up the story. They've just kind of unloaded on their dad what happened when they were in Egypt. They met this mysterious Egyptian man who accused them of being spies. They kept their oldest, or one of the brothers, Simeon. And then here's what Jacob says in response. Remember, Jacob being, you know, the one through whom the promise of Jesus was going to come, through Abraham's great faith. I mean, he's supposed to be a man of great faith. And here's what he said. Their father, Jacob, said to them, "You have deprived me of my children. Joseph is no more, and Simeon is no more, and now you want to take Benjamin. Everything is against me." Now, two words you're always supposed to use are always and never. And everything, maybe. I mean, throw that in there. Everything is against me. This world, the limits, I mean, it's just all so much. This is Debbie Downer at her finest. Everything is against me. Now, let's just kind of think rationally about this for a minute, because Jacob had 12 children. Yes, one was killed at an early age, according to Jacob. He didn't know what really happened to Joseph. One was killed. Another one was in prison, but he had 10 children. Yes, there were some lemons in there, and there were some negative experiences that he dealt with in life, but was everything against him? Was everything really against him? Let me ask you a question. When you get the lemons, is that your response? Everything's against me? It's so bad. I mean, everything, the world is closing in on me. He couldn't see reality. As I said, what defines our life isn't the presence or absence of lemons. What defines our lives is what we do in response to the lemons we've been given. And Jacob responded in doubt. He responded in despair. But he could have, and I would argue should have, responded in confident trust that God is still there. Yeah, the circumstances aren't perfect, but God hasn't abandoned me. Now, the brothers, they brought back grain, and Joseph had slipped their silver back in their packs. And so the brothers brought back grain, but it didn't last forever. And so after a while, they discovered that they were hungry again. And so Jacob spoke up. And here's what he said. It says, now the famine was still severe in the land, so when they had eaten all the grain they had brought from Egypt, their father said to them, go back and buy us a little more food. I just find this verse really funny. Like, go back and it's like we ran out of milk, guys. Go to the store. Forget that it's a multi-day journey, that it took you a while to go there and back, you know, but just go buy us a little bit more food. And notice he neglects talking about Benjamin. Because he doesn't want Benjamin to go, and perhaps he's hoping that the brothers have forgotten about Benjamin, that they'll just forget about it. But Judah kind of reminded him, and Judah spoke up. Here's what Judah said. He said, if you will send our brother along with us, we'll go down and buy food for you, but if you will not send him, we will not go down, because the man said to us, you will not see my face again unless your brother is with you. You're not going to see me. Bring your brother, or else. And so Judah speaks up and he says, look, I will vouch for the boy. I will keep him safe. I will be the responsible party if something happens to him. And so he guarantees Judah's life. And Jacob, he decides to send gifts to Joseph, not knowing that it's Joseph, to this Egyptian ruler. He sends gifts trying to convince the people that, you know, convince the Egyptian they're not really spies. It's okay. And so the brothers go. And Joseph sees them from a distance, and he tells his steward, hey, I want you to, you know, go kill an animal, take them to my house. And once they're at my house, we're going to have a feast. And in that response, the brothers were frightened. They were concerned. Here's what the text says in verse 18. Now, the men were frightened when they were taken to his house because they were looking through lemon-colored glasses, and that's all they could see was the lemony, you know, future, the worst-case scenario. They thought, we were brought here because of the silver that was put back into our sacks the first time. He wants to attack us and overpower us, seize us as slaves, and here's the worst one, and take our donkeys, right? I mean, if only he didn't take the donkeys, everything would have been okay. But no, he's going to take our donkeys too. That's like the icing on the cake. I don't know. Anyway, that struck me as kind of humorous when I read that. And so he's going to take all this stuff. I mean, they're just looking at it so negatively through the lemon-colored glasses. And my question is, what colored glasses do you look through? When lemons come your way, when the pandemic hits, when the election is raging, when there are racial challenges in our country, what color are your glasses? Lemon? Negative? Despair? See, the question that I think they need to wrestle with, and perhaps we need to wrestle with too, is where was their faith in God? Where was their confidence in God? Not confidence that their circumstances would be perfect, not confidence that things would be easy, because God never promised that. God never promised, you know, lollipops and clowns, if you're not afraid of clowns along the way. He never promised easy. He promised that he's good. And he promised that he's working all things together for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purposes. So where was their faith? Because all they could see is what they thought was going to happen to them. What they didn't see was what God was doing behind the scenes. How God was working in Joseph's life, in Joseph's heart. How he was saving lives through this, as we're about to see. God was up to something good, even though they couldn't see it in this moment. So Joseph, he inquired about his father, and then the text says this. He says, as he looked about and he saw his brother Benjamin, his own mother's son, he asked, is this your youngest brother, the one you told me about? And he said, God be gracious to you, my son. And I have to believe he was choking up as he's communicating this to Benjamin. And then the text says, deeply moved at the sight of his brother, Joseph hurried out and looked for a place to weep. He went into his private room and wept there. The emotion, I just can't even imagine the emotion that he was going through. After he had washed his face, he came out and, controlling himself, said, serve the food. And they were seated at separate tables. It was probably a little bit of a strange, you know, Thanksgiving dinner, as Joseph's sitting at his one table with his own food, and he gave extra portions to Benjamin, and the brothers are all seated at their table. And then they get ready to part ways. The brothers are given grain so that they can head home, and that's where things get a little bit interesting. The text says this, now Joseph gave these instructions to the steward of his house, fill the men's sacks with as much food as they can carry, and put each man's silver in the mouth of his sack. And then he continued on. He said, then put my cup, the silver one, in the mouth of the youngest one's sack, along with the silver for his grain. And he did as Joseph said. Now, my guess is you may know where this is going. So morning came, the men get ready to set out. And after they'd gone a little while, the text says this, they had not gone far from the city when Joseph said to his steward, go after these men at once, and when you catch up with them, say to them, why have you repaid evil for good? Isn't this the cup my master drinks from and also uses for divination? This is a wicked thing you have done. Now, I highlighted the word divination because I just want to explain it a little bit. Remember, at this point in time, the brothers have no idea it's Joseph. They have no idea that they're talking to their brother. He's been keeping up the ruse the entire time. He's been pretending to be Egyptian. He's been speaking through an interpreter. And so this is just, I believe, part of him keeping that up. He didn't use the cup for divination, as we're going to see. He orchestrated the whole thing. I mean, that's what was going on. So, I mean, this is a wicked thing you have done. Now, just imagine the brothers as they received news of this. I mean, they were just thinking, oh my goodness, we got out of here. We made it out and we kept all of us with us, right? I mean, we were able to actually go home. My father's going to be so excited. Our father's going to be so excited when he sees us. And then this happened. And they're thinking, steal your cup? Why would any of us steal your cup? Here's what they said in verse 9. He said, if any of your servants is found to have it, he will die, and the rest of us will become my Lord's slaves. That's how confident we are that nobody took your cup. And so the steward, he went through every man's bag, and he began opening them up and digging through them, kind of like at the airport with the TSA, right? I mean, they're digging through, looking for stuff. He goes from oldest all the way down to the youngest, one by one, and finally he gets to Benjamin's bag, and he opens it up, and he's digging through, and lo and behold, there's the cup. The worst thing imaginable has just happened to the brothers. And in this moment, they have to decide what to do. Now, 20 years earlier, they abandoned Joseph. They sold him into slavery. But this time, they didn't abandon Benjamin. I think something had been going on in their hearts. I think God had been doing something in them as they watched their father go through the incredible pain of having lost one of their children. So he turned around. They all turned around, probably bowed their heads in shame and concern and fear, and they headed back to Joseph's house, where he was, interestingly enough, waiting for them, probably wondering who was actually going to show up at his door in just a few minutes. So here's what the text says. Joseph was still in the house when Judah and his brothers came in, and they threw themselves to the ground before him. Joseph said to them, what is this you have done? Don't you know? Aren't you smart enough to figure out that a man like me can find things out by divination? I mean, did you really think you could get away with it? Did you really? Now, again, this wasn't divination. He had the cup planted there. He knew that. Don't you know? Don't you know that I know all? And so Judah, the one who had sold Joseph into slavery, it was Judah's idea to sell Joseph into slavery. Judah, the one who had promised his father Benjamin's life, that I will bring Benjamin back. Judah, who apparently was the spokesman for the group, he spoke up. And here's what he said. He said, what can we say to my Lord? Judah replied. What can we say? How can we prove our innocence? God has uncovered your servant's guilt. Of course, they weren't guilty of this. Judah's referring to what had happened 20 years ago when he sold his brother into slavery. He knew he was guilty. He carried that guilt probably every single day of his life. God has uncovered your servant's guilt. We are now my Lord's slaves. We ourselves and the one who was found to have the cup. I would rather be your slave than go back and face my father. I would rather be your slave than have to look my father in the eyes and tell him that I lost his new favorite son. But Joseph, he said this. He said, far be it from me to do such a thing. Only the man who is found to have the cup will become my slave. The rest of you go back to your father in peace. Except there would be no peace, and surely Joseph knew that. Surely he knew there could be no peace as long as Benjamin wasn't there. So then the drama unfolded even more. Then Judah, the text continues, went up to him and said, "Pardon your servant, my lord. Let me speak a word to you, my lord. Do not be angry with your servant, though you are equal to Pharaoh himself." And then he began recounting the entire experience, how he and his brothers, they had come to Egypt looking for food because of the famine. They had told the truth. They were accused of being spies. Joseph found out that they had this younger brother and a father. They brought the brother back as promised. He went through this whole account, and then he said, "Look, we had to twist my dad's arm in order to even bring Benjamin." He didn't want to release Benjamin because Benjamin is so important to him. He said this, he says, "So now, if the boy is not with us, when I go back to your servant, my father, and if my father, whose life is closely bound up with the boy's life," I mean, this is how deeply Jacob loved the boy. He said, "If he sees that the boy isn't there, he will die." I mean, this will put him in the grave. This will put him in the grave. He goes on, he says, "Your servant guaranteed the boy's safety to my father. I said, if I do not bring him back to you, I will bear the blame before you, my father, all my life." Now again, I can only imagine the emotion that they are all feeling in these moments. Because then Judah said something that was so out of character for Judah, at least out of character from what Joseph knew of Judah, but it was a reflection of what God was doing in Judah. He said, "Now then, please let your servant remain here as my Lord's slave in place of the boy, and let the boy return with his brothers. My life for his. I will give my life for his, but I cannot bear to see my father suffer again. Take my life and set the boy free." And Joseph, when he heard these words, it was too much. It was too much. He cleared the room, he sent his attendants out, and he began wailing and weeping as he revealed himself to his family. And it was so loud, the servants heard it, because there are no secrets. Where you own servants, secrets don't exist. And it made it to Pharaoh's house. And here's what Joseph said. He said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. I am Joseph." I can only imagine what they're thinking as he's saying all this. "Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified. I mean, they're speechless. They were afraid before. They are terrified now as they are standing in the presence of the second most powerful man in the ancient world. I mean, Joseph could do anything to them, and they knew what they had done to Joseph. And so realizing their terror, I believe, he spoke up. And Joseph said, continuing on to his brothers, "Come close to me." And when they had done so, he said, "I'm your brother Joseph, right? I'm the one you sold into Egypt. Remember me, guys? Do you remember me? I'm Joseph." Of course they remembered him. They tried to forget and they couldn't. I mean, they remembered him every day of their lives. They remembered him every time they saw their father mourning over his lemons. Of course they knew who Joseph was. But he said this, he said, "And now, do not be distressed, because I know you are, and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because, again, I know you are. Because it was to save lives that God sent me." It was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you, because God is turning lemons into lemonade. And it looks like this terrible situation, it looks like something bad is going on, and there were terrible things. You delivered me a whole bunch of lemons in my life. But God is doing something here. God has not abandoned me. God is good. He sent me to preserve life. You tried to take my life. But God's bigger than that. Now the rest of the story finishes where the brothers go home, they gather their families, more than 70 people move to the land of Egypt because there are a lot of years left in the famine and there's plenty in Egypt, and so Joseph ends up caring for his family. They end up living there for 400 years. They grow into a nation of people, the Israelite people, before Moses ends up setting them free from slavery. And when they are there, Jacob ends up dying. And when Jacob dies, the brothers start getting concerned again because they have this overwhelming fear that Joseph has only kept them alive to appease their father. And so they go to him, they bow down, they beg him not to kill them. They say, we'll be your slaves. Here's what Joseph said in response. We looked at this the very first week. He said, you intended to harm me. You intended to harm me. But God intended it for good. You wanted to hurt me, but God was doing something good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I'll provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. You wanted to hurt me, but God had something good. I can look back and I say, God worked things together for good. There have been lots of lemons in my life. But Joseph would say, I can stand here and say, God is good. And I have faith, I have confidence in that. You know, sometimes in the religious world, faith is believed to be this power. And if we just have enough faith, if we just believe enough, we can twist God's arm into doing what it is that we want him to do, whether it's a healing or, you know, getting a job or getting a date on Friday night. I mean, whatever it is, it's like I just need to have enough faith and God will do the very thing that I want him to do. But that's not faith. That is not faith. Faith isn't a power. Faith isn't forcing God's hand. Faith isn't confidence in your desired outcome. Faith is confidence in the God who controls outcomes. That God is who he says he is, that he'll do all he has promised to do, regardless of what I think in the moments. It's not confidence that everything's going to be perfect in my life. It's not confidence that everything's going to be easy. It's confidence in the God who is in control. And somehow, in the midst of my free will and my own choices, God is sovereign. He's in control over all these things, and he is working things together for good. What we talked about in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, what Paul said, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. It's confidence that God is good, not confidence in what I want, confidence in the God who's in control. And I got to ask you the question, how would your life look different if you adopted the same kind of statement that Joseph made? You intended to harm me, but God. But God intended it for good. This pandemic intended to harm me, but God. My ex intended to harm me, but God. I didn't get the promotion, but God. My car broke down, but God. And he was able to see the good in spite of it. And I'm telling you, that is what defined Joseph's life. It was his attitude in response to the lemons he received in life. Now, I want to be clear. This isn't about putting artificial sweetener on the bad things that happen to us in life. This isn't about putting the fake smile. You know, sometimes Christians can be accused of acting like everything's perfect when things are clearly a train wreck. I don't think Joseph did that. I mean, he lived 20 years of, honestly, a literal hell. I mean, 20 years of his life were spent, or 13 years, rather, of his life were spent as a slave and in prison. There's nothing sweet about that. But in the midst of it, he responded with godly character of kindness, of grace, of patience, in believing the best while the worst was happening to him, in showing love and forgiveness. Quite honestly, it's the same character traits that Jesus showed when he's on the cross, as he showed kindness, as he looked at those who were crucifying him and said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. Telling you, your life won't be defined by your lack of lemons or your presence of lemons. It will be defined by whether or not you can display confidence in God in the midst of your lemons. So I got to ask you, it's kind of the question that's being begged, what's your attitude with your lemons? When life gives you lemons, what's your immediate response? Is it to freak out? Is it to get angry? To get revenge, to point fingers, to just kind of close down and shut down? Or is it to respond in faith and say, I don't understand this circumstance. I'm not thankful necessarily for this circumstance, but I know God is still in control. I know that he is somehow working things together for good, and I can't see it in this moment, but I trust that at some point in time, at some point down the road, I will see it. And you may wonder, you know, how do I even begin doing that? How do I begin doing that? And I'll just tell you how I do it, because, you know, I had some lemony experiences even in the last week as my car broke down or clothes dryer broke and dealing with a bunch of other stuff. And it's like, oh my goodness. I mean, how can all of this stuff happen in 1 week? And I just found myself laughing and chuckling at what the message was for today and what God is inviting me to teach other people. And so I look at that and I just say, okay, God, give me confidence. Give me confidence that you're working things together for my good. Help me to have faith that you're working things together for my good, and then give me strength to persevere through this. Help me to have confidence, God, that you are still there. Help me to have confidence that you care deeply about me, that you are working things together for my good, because, God, you are for me. You are for me. And then give me perseverance not to give up believing that. Help me to hold on tight till I get to the other side. And I can see the good that you're doing. I can't see it right now, but give me confidence that it's there. I'm telling you, Joseph lived 4,000 years ago, but this truth is no less true today as it was 4,000 years ago. Even 2,000 years ago, the Apostle Paul, he wrote this letter to the church in Philippi, and here's what he said, Philippians 4, verse 12. He said, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want, the highs, lows, lemons, lemonade, whatever it is. He says, I can do all this through him who gives me strength. My confidence is in the one who controls outcomes, not in a specific outcome. So what is your response? What is your attitude to the lemons you have in life? And could you have the courage of going before God rather than just trying to find the solution yourself and just say, God, I have confidence. I believe you're still in control. My friends, that is true today as much as it was 1 year ago before the pandemic hit. It's true today more than it was, as much as it was 4 years ago before our first election of contention. It's as true today as it was 2,000, 4,000 years ago. God is no less in control. The question is, how will we respond to the lemons we've been given? And the thing that we discover is that what was so sour eventually does become sweet. Now, in light of that, today we're going to send you home with something. You've got your own box of lemon heads. And the reason for this, sorry for those of you watching online, if you want to email church@icommunitychurch.com, and Ann's going to kill me for that, in the next 2 days, we'll send you your own box of lemon heads. You're welcome, Ann. She's giving me dirty looks. When life gives you lemons. Yeah, that's right. But the reason we're giving these to you is because, you know, they're sour at the beginning, but you suck on them long enough and they start to turn sweet. And on the back of it, we put Romans 8:28, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to spend some time learning this. And there's a little reward here, right? I mean, this is conditioning. All you do is you say the verse, and you eat a lemon head. And then the next day, you say the verse, eat the lemon head, and you just kind of keep doing that, and eventually, it'll stick with you. But remember that God is doing something, and we can have confidence. Not that the circumstances are going to look awesome in the moment, but that God is up to something good. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much. Thank you for Joseph's life story that has been preserved. It is such a rich story, God, and I pray that we would cling to the knowledge and the truth that you are sovereign, that you are in control, and that you are working things together for the good of those who love you. Lord, I pray that for those in the room who are just dealing with a bunch of lemons right now, and life is so sour, I pray that today would be a day that they could declare their confidence in you, and that they would seek you for perseverance, and that you would give them what they need in order to persevere through the challenge. God, I pray as we look back on 2020 that we would see something good from this season, Thank you for the good that you are working. Father, give each one of us wisdom to know what we need to do, and then give us the courage to do it in response to what we've heard today. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Seth. Such a poignant message we all need to hear during this time. I hope you have enjoyed this series. If you've missed any of these weeks, I would strongly encourage you to go online, give them a listen. If there's any time, it's now that we need to have confidence and faith in God. Hey, couple things before you go. Next week, we are starting a brand new series. That series is called This Is Us. And if you are newer here or you know someone who you'd like to invite to church, this is a perfect time to invite them. We're going to be talking about who we are as a church and our vision. Seth, Dan, and myself are all three going to be talking about that over the next 4 weeks. So I hope you enjoy that. Last thing before you go is I would ask for your prayers this week that not too many people email in so Seth can live on that Lemonhead promise in the mail. So if you could remember to pray for that. Anyways, we will see you next week. Have a wonderful week. Thank you guys for tuning in online. We look forward to seeing you again next week.